Buenas tardes, muchas gracias. Es un gusto acompañarlos a ustedes en esta tarde. Como recién les decían, este es el panel sobre globalización y desarrollo. Les pido un fuerte aplauso para nuestros tres panelistas, para Johan Nordberg, del Cato Institute, para Douglas Irwin, de Dartmouth College, y para Felipe Lavalce, que es consejero académico de Libertad y Progreso. Como recién planteaban en esta introducción, pareciera que la globalización está bajo asedio. A más de 30 años de aquel escrito de Francis Fukuyama sobre el fin de la historia, parece que estamos nuevamente discutiendo los beneficios de la globalización. Y de eso se trata justamente este panel. ¿De qué vamos a estar hablando hoy entonces en globalización y desarrollo? Vamos a estar hablando de por qué la globalización importa, ¿por qué es importante el libre comercio y el capitalismo? Vamos a hacer un repaso con ellos sobre los beneficios del capitalismo global. Vamos a estar hablando también con nuestros panelistas sobre la superioridad moral del capitalismo. Y al final del día, para hacer un hilo conductor con el primer panel de la mañana que nos hablaba de la cultura de la libertad, pensar que la globalización, el comercio, al final del día lo hacemos los individuos, que la acción humana es el fundamento de la globalización. Entonces, una vez más, les pido un fuerte aplauso para nuestro primer panelista, que es Johan Nordberg. Johan es académico titular del Instituto Cato, escritor especializado en la globalización, el progreso humano y la historia universal intelectual. Es autor y editor de más de 20 libros que han sido traducidos a más de 30 idiomas y les recomiendo, porque lo estudié antes de venir a este panel, tiene una página que se llama johannordberg.net y muchos de sus documentales también los pueden encontrar en freetochoose.tv. Un aplauso, bienvenido Johan.
Thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me to this extraordinary event. And I'm proud to be part of such a distinguished panel from which I've learned so much, and I will keep doing that today, I'm sure. I'm excited to be here and to talk about globalization and development, especially as a Swede in Argentina. Because Swedes visiting Argentina know a thing or two about the potential of this country. Sweden's national bard, our greatest singer-songwriter, Evert Taube, he lived in Argentina in the early 20th century. And he wrote about his beloved Argentina, the beautiful nature, lovely people, but also the sense of adventure, the high-paying jobs, the future that he saw in Argentina back then. Because Argentina was then around 40% richer than Sweden was, and this was the place to go to find not just adventure, but also wealth and potential. One of Evert Taube's most famous songs is about the beautiful Carmencita, who's a great tango dancer, and he proposes to her, but she says, no, there's another one, another guy coming, an Argentinian, and he's wealthy, he's got more cattle, and he's a great tango dancer, so I'm afraid this will not do, my dear friend. But then the roles reversed, and 100 years later, Sweden is now 4 times richer on a per capita GDP basis at current currency exchange rates. What happened in between during those 100 years? The thing that happened was that we Swedes found a machine, an incredible machine, the best imaginable machine. It's not just one that can turn Sweden's forests and timber into food, or its iron ore and steel into furniture, but actually can do the reverse and turn timber into any kind of goods, services, even software. A machine that can turn anything into anything else. Anything you got, anything that you are able to produce, and on the other side of the machine, you can take out whatever you need, whatever that happens to be. And the great thing about this incredible machine is that it's a very realistic one, and it's called global capitalism and international exchange. That beautiful machine that makes our work more valuable, our ideas more valuable, because we can turn it into anything else that we're not able to produce. So suddenly Sweden's farmers could grow cars and computers in the wheat fields. Suddenly, workers at their conveyor belts could assemble financial services and cell phones, and a programmer could code himself a bottle of wine and a new sofa. This metaphor of trade as a machine tells us something important about what trade is, and the fact that the most important aspect is that we get something out of the machines. Imports, right? This is what we must remember in a neo-mercantilist era, when all the politicians and lots of big businesses say that exports are good, but imports are bad, and we should try to limit them. They're too cheap. But of course, the most important thing is not how much we put into the machine, but the fact that we can get as much as possible out of it on the other side. Exports, that's Monday morning going to work. Imports, that's payday. And obviously, we want more pay from the work that we put into it. This is what trade and globalization is really about. And it shows that arguments for protectionism and tariffs are all versions of the Luddite argument that we want less bang for our bucks. We want less goods coming out of the machines from all the work that we're producing. But not just goods and services, because this is also how we acquire capacity, acquire new ideas and new innovations. New ideas and technologies spreading around the world. That's what happens when we have access to globalization, to global markets, and to the brains and the hard work of people in other parts of the world. Combinations, new exciting things coming when ideas and technologies clash. Argentina's greatest writer, Jorge Luis Borges, he once put it this way when talking about literature, that the translation of Don Quixote, of Cervantes' Don Quixote, is far superior to the original. Not just because he loved the English language, but also because it added something new, an extra vantage point, and those combinations and those clashes that creates magic. Like when Spanish beef cows for the first time came to Buenos Aires in the 1580s, combining it with the pampas and the fertile soil and the climate here. Or the Malbec grape came from the French to Argentina in the 1850s, combining it with the dry sunny climate and the right altitude, and suddenly we have something great to drink to this steak that we're having. And perhaps to combine an Argentinian with Austrian economists, and suddenly we might have the best hope for American and European libertarianism that there is. Spreading the best ideas and combining the best ideas and technologies, that's what keeps us going. That's what keeps development going. Because sometimes we don't even know what our greatest contributions are. We can just put it out there and see what others prefer and what they do with it. Nobody knows our legacy. You know, Kalashnikov, the guy with the AK-47 and the AK-74, he thought that he would really be remembered for his poetry. But that's not what happened, because he produced something else that was of interest to people. Something interesting, sometimes destructive, happens when you go out there and trade test your ideas, as my dear friend, the great Deirdre McCloskey, always talks about. It doesn't happen by planning, it doesn't happen by committee, it happens when you trade test and combine ideas and put them out there. Well, for a long time, many governments denied their populations access to this great globalization machine, like Argentina, for a very long time. However, in recent decades, more and more countries have opened up to the rest of the world, liberalized markets, and liberated their people. After 1990, with the fall of dictatorships and the liberalization of markets, suddenly we got an era of globalization. Capitalism was suddenly free to lapse into its most savage form, as the Canadian socialist Naomi Klein puts it. Well, let's see what that savagery really meant in terms of indicators of human living standards. If we try to measure the wealth that mankind has attained by looking at GDP per capita, around half of all the wealth that we have ever produced was produced during these years since 1990. Extreme poverty was reduced from almost 4 out of 10 people on the planet to less than 1 out of 10 people today. And it's not just about China. China liberalized markets, started to compete on international markets and did great progress until the recent backlash. But it's not just about China, which some people propose once in a while. Even if we exclude China, extreme poverty was reduced by two-thirds around the world. The greatest and most impressive and fastest improvement of human living standards that the world has ever seen. Child mortality was reduced almost by two-thirds, which means that last year, 8 million child deaths were avoided, and it happened the fastest in the places that opened up to the best ideas, technologies, goods and services from other people. And remember, this is capitalism after it had lapsed into its most savage form. So, thank you, savagery. Had this been accomplished by a government program, do you think they would ever have shut up about it? I think they would have written musicals about these achievements. I think they would have erected statues and national holidays with great marching bands talking about how they finally beat global poverty. But now, it just happened because people wanted to improve their lives and got a little bit more freedom to do it. And therefore, we only hear about the complaints, about greed, about inequality. We rarely think about what made this possible and why it has never been possible before in human history. There are many old complaints about globalization and free trade, but the one that has most potency right now is that, yes, it might buy us better living standards, it might make us all richer, it might reduce poverty, but at what cost? We are suddenly making ourselves dependent on fragile global supply chains, which might fracture. We saw that during the pandemic, how suddenly we didn't get access to important inputs and goods and services that we needed. And therefore, we have to start to repatriate more production. We have to have more friend-shoring. We should trade more with people who are our good geopolitical friends rather than people who might not have our best interest at heart. This, I think, is a complete misreading of what happened during the pandemic. In fact, the opposite happened. And repatriation and the new protectionism that we're getting and friend-shoring that we're seeing will make us poorer, less productive. It would decrease specialization, but it will also make us less secure. We know that because now when we're looking into what really happened during the pandemic, the great thing was that as a friend of mine who's a little bit of a prepper, who had his basement full of canned food and fresh water, he told me that the worst year in human history to be a prepper was in 2020. During the pandemic, because he thought that now, when the world is shutting down and more than half the world's population is under house arrest, finally, you will not mock me anymore for having all this canned food in my basement. But on the contrary, you will see, you will beg me for these resources. But he found out that in a matter of days, sometimes hours, all those goods were back on shelves anywhere where we have relatively free markets and free trade. And who did best? Which businesses and countries did best? Counterintuitively, those with the most complex supply chains were fastest at putting goods back onto the shelves because they were used to looking for alternatives and they invested more in their trading partners and they were used to constantly maneuvering to find new opportunities in other places. Whereas those who had short, simple supply chains, only one supplier, well, if that supplier happened to be in a place under lockdown or a natural disaster, then that's game over. Only the ones with more complex supply chains prospered in this situation. And we saw that again in 2022 with infant baby formula in the United States, one sector that had really been repatriated with regulations that made it impossible even to import infant formula from Europe, and to tariffs that made it impossible to import it from the rest of the world. Felt safe. Everything was repatriated. It was close at hand, right? That's great. If it weren't for the fact that then all it takes is problems in one production facility in the spring of 2022, and you end up with a national shortage. That's what happened with close, short supply chains. It sounds counterintuitive, but you've heard it before. That's why the old saying does not go, put all your eggs in one basket and protect it with regulations and tariffs. Because one basket of eggs is one single point of failure. If you fail there, it's game over. We shouldn't concentrate risks, we should diversify risks as much as possible, and that's what globalization and trade helps us do. Even diversifying it to some of our geopolitical rivals, and to have that opportunity. Anytime when people talk to me about friendshoring, I think about what happened in Europe in early 2020. There were a few countries that tried to stop countries like Sweden, Spain, and Italy from getting face masks and getting access to personal protective equipment. And that was Germany and France, some of our best geopolitical allies and friends. We love them. But they imposed export bans, and more than that, France even confiscated protective equipment just going through France on the way to another country somewhere else. The country that saved us was China, because they suddenly exported, scaled up production to more than three times the global production in 2019 and exported it to the rest of the world. Not because Xi Jinping is a better friend of ours than France and Germany, but because we were already dependent on France and Germany. They're close to us, and most disasters, most problems are local and regional by nature. That's a single point of failure. We need the same stuff at the same time. So having diversified risks and being able to buy from factories that happens to be not under lockdown for that particular moment is good. Geopolitical sentimentality, there's a place for that, but not when it comes to trade. Then diversification is more important. So there we have it. I don't think the new arguments stand up against trade either. The case for this incredible machine of globalization is stronger than ever. The opponents keep coming up with theoretical challenges, and that's why we do what we do. But as Borges put it, the world, unfortunately, is real. And you can't wish it away, and you can't wish the facts away. The track record is absolutely clear. Globalization is still the best hope for development and for mankind. But it's not predetermined, it's not automatic, it's a choice that we have to do. To Swedes in the 1910s and 1920s, Argentina was the country of the future, the country of opportunity and adventure. By tearing down self-imposed barriers, it could be so once again. Thank you.
Qué gran orador para esta tarde. Un fuerte aplauso para Johan. Vamos a recibir, para continuar con nuestro panel de desarrollo y globalización, globalización y desarrollo. Y les recuerdo que desde la app El Renacer de la Libertad, que ustedes la pueden descargar, tienen ahí para ir mandando preguntas al panel que de alguna manera mágicamente después se van a transmitir a la tablet que tengo ahí para que tengamos un espacio de preguntas con nuestros oradores. Douglas Irwin es profesor de economía del Dartmouth College, es autor de numerosos libros, uno en particular me llamó la atención, cuyo título es Free Trade Under Fire, que es del año 2020. Profesor Irwin es también investigador asociado del National Bureau of Economic Research y Senior Fellow no residente en el Peter Institute for International Economics. Douglas Irwin, muchas gracias por acompañarnos. Te escuchamos entonces. Un aplauso, por favor, para él también.
Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here, and Johan gave a tremendous introduction to this topic of globalization and freer trade. And I'd like to drill down just a little bit and provide some more context on what's been going on in the past few decades in the trade, and in particular, what the implications are for Argentina going forward. So, there's free trade in theory, and then there's free trade in practice. I have this book called Against the Tide, an Intellectual History of Free Trade, which goes through the theory, starts well before Adam Smith, but talks about Adam Smith as being a very important person in developing the ideas, and then it talks about the various attacks that have been made on free trade over the years, and how the idea still sustains. It's still with us. It still matters. But regardless of the theory, what about practice? How does free trade work out in practice? And it turns out that we have had a test of free trade in practice during a very particular decade, the decade from 1985 to 95 into 2005 or so, so about 20 years. I put neoliberalism in quotation marks. It's often called the neoliberalism era, a lot of critics, but it was a historically unique period in human history in terms of opening up and creating the globalized world that we have today, as you so eloquently pointed out. Many countries, not just China, India, Vietnam, Bangladesh, Chile before them, so many countries opened up. And what did we see during that period? Impressive global growth, convergence in incomes, poverty reduction, and the unfortunate thing is Argentina missed out on a lot of it. Although they did have their era, and we are here in Puerto Madero, which is a legacy of the 1990s and liberalization that took place then. But Argentina, I think, can recapture some of those benefits. So this is just a picture showing the number of countries that opened up. Going back to 1960, and you can see very few in the 60s, very few in the 70s. Chile was on the vanguard. But from 1985 to 95, the world changed. So many countries opened up. This is not just the fall of the Berlin Wall. Of course, that was very important. But it created the globalized world we're in today. And what happened? Robert Lawson will speak a little bit later. He has the Index of Economic Freedom. The world is sort of flat here in terms of this freedom to trade. This is an index of freedom to trade. It's sort of flat until 1985. It begins to pick up until 1995 or 2000 or so, and it sort of tailed off. But there's that convergence. The rest of the world moved towards more open markets and more freedom to trade. Tariffs came down across the developing world. They're already relatively low in the United States and Western Europe. But in the developing world, South America, South Asia, Africa, Southeast Asia, those tariffs were very high starting in 1980, but between 1980, 85 or so, and 1995, they came down. Once again, this changed the world in which we live. This is just a way of thinking about globalization. This is the world trade to GDP ratio. It's one indicator about how integrated the world economy is. World trade to world GDP, going back to 1820. And you can see that first era of globalization. There are five eras of globalization. The first era, that's when Argentina did so well, particularly towards the end of that. The world trade to GDP ratio is rising a bit. Then we hit era two, the interwar period, where there's this implosion, protectionism, economic nationalism, the Smoot-Hawley tariff, the Great Depression. Global integration shrinks. In phase three, we have this rebound after World War II. The U.S. helps create the GATT, and we start moving towards lower trade barriers, at least in North America, Western Europe, and elsewhere. But it's really this period four, where we have this explosion in globalization, and so many more countries become part of the global economy. Now we're unfortunately in period five, where it's flat, and countries are not liberalizing. But I want to talk about the legacy of that period four, when globalization is taking off. So what do the studies show, the academic studies show about income as a result of countries opening up? Here's one study by two colleagues of mine. Is Washington Consensus dead? Here's the bottom line. They divide the world into countries that liberalized and those that did not. And once again, liberalization starts in the mid-1980s, and by the early 2000s, those countries that liberalized enjoyed a higher per capita income, about 15 to 20% above those that did not liberalize. Higher incomes, more gains from trade, productivity growth, product variety, there's so many ways you can document this, they did better. Here's another study. Using synthetic control methods, we don't have to get into the details, is trying to come up with a plausible counterfactual path for a country that does not liberalize. And it goes through all these scenarios, looks at Costa Rica, Mexico, Barbados, and the actual performance is much better than a counterfactual in which the country did not liberalize. But guess what? You don't have to read all those studies or understand the econometrics or the details. I summarized it all in an article that's coming out in the World Bank Research Observer, coming out, it's on my website. It's just a review of all the evidence from that period and just summarizes all the studies. There's more than a dozen of them, and they're almost uniform. It's not like this one hand on the other hand. We don't know what happened. All the studies looking at different methods, different countries, different data, come to the same conclusion. big benefits from trade liberalization. What country is this? Well, why am I showing a picture? We can do all these academic studies, we can study the data, but seeing is believing. What city is this? It's not a rhetorical question, but I'll answer it. This is Seoul, Korea in 1965. What are the people doing? They're washing their clothes in the river. What does South Korea export now around the world? Washing machines. This is South Korea, downtown Seoul in 1960. Here's that same river today. South Korea's exports as a share of GDP in 1960 was 1%. 1% of GDP. That's an incredibly small trade ratio because they're incredibly isolated from the world economy. Now, of course, the Korean trade to GDP ratio and import to GDP ratio is about 30-40% or so. So they have taken advantage of global trade. Deirdre McCloskey mentioned India. India's flourished since 1991 and getting rid of the license raj. But what's unheralded is Bangladesh also opened up. You don't hear about them. When I was growing up, Bangladesh was considered one of the poorest countries in the world. And now it has overtaken India in terms of per capita GDP. They have been a quiet, stealth reformer, and their trade to GDP ratio has soared, and they have brought millions of people out of poverty. In fact, let's look at poverty, as Johan was mentioning. This is going back to 1900, world extreme poverty. You know, it's going down a bit, but it's not going very fast. And what happens after 1980 or 85 when we have this globalization era? It plummets. As Johan mentioned, this is not just China. Take out China, the numbers still go down a lot because it's Bangladesh and India and Vietnam and so many other countries around the world. And this is revolutionary. It is world historic. Deirdre McCloskey, myself, we're economic historians. Economic historians will be studying this for many decades to come. The story from the Industrial Revolution up to the present has been increased global inequality. Some countries industrialized, others didn't. The gap between the rich and poor got wider and wider. There's the global Gini coefficient going up, up, up. Lant Pritchett, a famous development economist, wrote an article for the Journal of Economic Perspectives called Divergence Big Time. The world is diverging. What has happened in the 20 years since the 1990s or so in the liberalization? Boom. It undid, the world undid a century of increased inequality in 20 years because of the rise of developing countries that opened up and participated in global markets. And this was not a race to the bottom. It didn't bring down the advanced countries. It's the convergence process of other countries getting better technology and improving their standards of living. So let's turn to Argentina, which except for the 1990s seemed to have missed this. If we go way back, this is the trade to GDP ratio for Argentina, how well Argentina is integrated in global markets, going back to 1913. And what you can see is, up to the Belle Epoque, Argentina was a huge trader. The export plus import as a share of GDP ratio is about 80%, meaning exports are about 40% of GDP, imports are about 40% of GDP. And then it just falls because of greater protectionism, economic nationalism, peronism, and it remained flat for so long at about 20%, meaning the export or import to GDP ratio is about 10%, much smaller than otherwise would have been the case. As some colleagues put it, Argentine trade policy is 60 years of solitude, 60 years of not being a big part of the global economy. Withdrawing voluntarily from world trade. It wasn't the rest of the world rejecting Argentina. It was Argentina saying, we're not prepared to trade with the rest of the world. So where's Argentina today? If you look at just array countries, in terms of how, are you open or are you closed? Where's Argentina? Way down there with Brazil. Relatively closed economy. If we look on the left-hand side here, effective applied tariffs, taxes on imports, way off of Chile, Mexico, the OECD, Argentina, and Brazil stand alone. On the right-hand side, we have barriers to trade facilitation. Our government's interfering with trade, not through tariffs, but through, are they facilitating trade or not? Argentina, once again, is an outlier. It's not facilitating trade. It creates barriers to trade. More average tariffs. Once again, Argentina's off the charts. It's not a normal country in terms of participating in world trade. And you in Argentina know this. Prices are so much higher for these basic consumer goods that everyone in the rest of the world enjoys, and Chileans enjoy at world prices, much more expensive. My gosh, in Argentina, you make cell phones in Tierra del Fuego. To the rest of the world, that seems mind-boggling. Why would you produce them near Antarctica, so far from markets, when the cost is so high? Inward FDI stock. Argentina is not a place where there's a lot of inward foreign direct investment. Multinationals don't want to set up here. Once again, very low compared to the OECD average or other countries. Multinationals, they bring in technology. They bring in ideas. They bring in capital. You should be welcoming that, not rejecting it. All these problems, you know, it's easy to, you know, blame past policies or politicians. Raul Prebisch, sort of the intellectual forefather of import substitution. This is a report in 1950 which sort of outlined all the problems Latin America might have with trade and why it might want to restrict trade. He recognized within 10 years of writing that report there were big problems with import substitution. 1961, he said, it's been carried out with very serious flaws. In 1964, he said, it's created all these vested interests and prejudices as opposed to trade and has a severe effect on economic development, that attitude. So if he had been alive today and seen what's happened with the globalized world, even he might have said import substitution is not the way to go. So what does Argentina have to do? Learn from other countries. Other countries made this transition. Other countries opened up, other countries flourished, so what's the recipe? What do you have to do? All these other countries in the 1980s and 90s, when they opened up, if you look at them country by country, they did three things. They established a convertible currency. They converted quantitative restrictions on imports to import tariffs. Why? Because QRs are very restrictive and they don't raise revenue. Tariffs at least raise revenue, and then you can cut those tariffs over time. Now, trade economists such as myself, we tend to focus on those last two. Okay, get rid of quantitative restrictions on imports and cut tariffs. That's sort of almost the easy part of it. The first part, which often gets unnoticed and is very important for Argentina, is establishing a convertible currency. What all these other countries did is they had to devalue because they have an overvalued exchange rate, and an overvalued exchange rate is a killer of trade and a breeder of trade restrictions. You want to get rid of the black market premium. You want to unify the exchange rate. You don't want seven exchange rates. You want one. And that allows you to end import licensing. Why do you license import? Because you have to ration foreign exchange because your exchange rate's out of whack with market reality. It's overvalued. And then maintain a competitive real exchange rate thereafter. So exchange rate policy is very important in the opening up process, and Argentina has to get that right. So just to go back to the history for a moment, what was the big problem in the 60s, 70s, and 80s? So many countries around the world had overvalued currencies. They had high rates of inflation, they didn't adjust the nominal exchange rate, and they priced their exports out of the world markets, created excess demand for imports that you have to satisfy with import licensing. And that began to come down in the 80s and 90s. There's the number of countries with non-unified exchange rates. In other words, having multiple exchange rates. Once again, this reform era of the 1980s and 90s, it collapses. Countries are unifying their exchange rates and opening up their current account for payments purposes. They may still have high tariffs, but at least the current account is open for business. And this has been a chronic problem in Argentina. Here's the black market premium on the exchange rate from 1950. And it's up and down a lot, but look at the scale. The lowest is 50 here, and we're going up to 100, 200, 300%. If it's at 30 or 40, that's already a tax on your exports. It's an overvalued currency. The peso has been chronically overvalued. with just a few periods where it's not. When you look at an index of how open is Argentina to current account transactions on the trade account, it's not saying whether tariffs are high or low, but can you make payments? Can you buy imports? Can you get foreign exchange to do that? It's incredibly volatile. There are big periods of tightness where it's going down almost to zero. Very few periods where it's free, like close to 100, which is the 1990s under Cavallo. Comes back down under the Kirchners, back up under Macri. But when you look at the correlation between these two, it's almost perfectly negatively correlated. What does that mean? If you have an overvalued currency, you're going to close up the current account. You're going to restrict access to foreign exchange. And it doesn't matter whether the tariff is zero or 100%, you can't get foreign exchange to buy imports anyway. So what's the point of those tariffs? Argentines, you've been through this under the Kirchners recently with the non-automatic import licensing from 2012 to 2015. Look at the lower panel. It shows the nominal exchange rate in blue and then the market, the parallel market, the black market rate. The gap is widening. So what happens? Reserves, foreign exchange reserves go down, and the percent of imports that are approved by the government go down. In other words, the government's just basically banning imports to preserve foreign exchange reserves because the exchange rate is out of whack. Even today, there's a gap between the official rate and the parallel market rate. And even though the current government just had a big devaluation early on, they didn't go down to the market rate, and they've had this crawling depreciation, about 2%, but inflation is higher, so that gap has been widening, which means the real exchange rate has been appreciating. And here's just a picture of this. So this is a little bit confusing because exchange rates up and down can mean different things. Up here means a depreciation, a down means an appreciation. So notice what's happening. It's been going down, which means the real value of the peso has been appreciating. It's been going this way. There's that big devaluation. But notice just four months later, it's already wiped out because of higher inflation. The exchange rate adjustment has not kept up with the pace of inflation. The real value of the peso has gone up. That's a tax on exporters. And that creates problems for the central bank in terms of its reserves. So, former foreign minister of Argentina said being closed to the world has not brought us good results. We see that the world has become protectionist, nationalist, populist, and we have done our master's, doctorate, and postdoctoral degrees in that. We see it does not work. Having a closed economy has not worked for Argentina. At some point, once there's macroeconomic stability, the government has to move towards opening up markets and getting access and becoming part of the world economy once again. And so that's what Argentina needs ultimately, to move towards a more open economy market economy. That means a convertible currency with one exchange rate, not seven, not two. That means no black market premium. And then you can undertake these unilateral reforms. I'll leave it to others on the panel to talk about things, but one idea, leave Mercosur. That's a protectionist racket. Just as Chile... You don't want to be tied to the high tariffs of Brazil. You want to strike out on your own the way Chile did in pulling out of the Andean Pact in the mid-1970s and go for free trade unilaterally as so many other countries have. Last point is, you got to get the exchange rate right and do not fix the exchange rate. It's going to blow up. It happened in Chile in the 1980s. It happened in Mexico in the mid-1990s. It happened here in Argentina in 2000-2001. You've got to let the exchange rate go because otherwise it's going to be very difficult to maintain open markets. You'll create a macroeconomic crisis, and that will undermine all the progress that will be made under this administration. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Douglas. Impresionante nuestros speakers. Son como los superhéroes de la globalización. Yo no les quiero prometer luz al final del camino, pero sí les voy a prometer un buen café. De todas maneras, cuando conversamos con ellos sobre este panel, una de las preguntas que nos hacíamos era justamente esta, ¿no? ¿Por qué hablar de globalización hoy en la Argentina? ¿Por qué la globalización es importante para la Argentina? ¿Qué podemos aprender de otros países? Y sobre ello nos va a seguir conversando nuestro próximo panelista, Felipe de la Valse, a quien recibimos con un fuerte aplauso, que es miembro de la Academia de la Empresa y de la Academia Nacional de Ciencias Morales y Políticas, es consejero académico de Libertad y Progreso, es autor y empresario también. Muchas gracias, Felipe, te invitamos entonces con tu disertación. Gracias.
Perfecto, gracias. Bueno, buenas tardes, muchas gracias a la Fundación Libertad y Progreso por esta invitación y la oportunidad de estar con ustedes y hacer algunas reflexiones sobre la situación internacional de la Argentina, lo que está pasando en el mundo, los cambios, la ebullición, los grandes cambios que están ocurriendo y qué tenemos que hacer o qué podemos hacer. Primero, con respecto a la situación de Argentina, quisiera darle algunos datos y les pido perdón porque no les van a parecer muy simpáticos, les van a parecer deprimentes, pero son importantes y muy consistentes con lo que ha explicado el profesor Irwin durante su exposición. Si miramos cuatro datos importantes de la inserción de Argentina en el mundo, el coeficiente de apertura, importaciones más exportaciones dividido 2 dividido PBI, 13%. Estamos entre los 10 países más cerrados del mundo. Participación en el comercio internacional. 1950, nuestra economía participaba en el 2.5% de la economía mundial en términos de comercio. 2.5. Hoy es 0.25, 10 veces menos. No es poca la diferencia. En otras palabras, la declinación ha sido muy grande y ha durado en el tiempo, ha sucedido gradualmente, pero ha sido muy dramática. Tercer punto, si miramos el patrón de comercio, tenemos un patrón de comercio sumamente concentrado en pocos productos, en pocos destinos y en muy pocas empresas. 70% de nuestras exportaciones son productos agrícolas o agroalimentarios, 70%. Después tenemos algunas otras cosas, pero lo fundamental es eso. Si miramos el número de empresas, 35 empresas explican el 66% de nuestras exportaciones, 35 empresas. Y ese número no es de estos últimos 2 años, es de los últimos 40 años o 35 años. En otras palabras, como les dije, lo que les iba a contar no era muy positivo en términos de inversión extranjera directa. Típicamente Argentina invertía, recibió inversiones extranjeras del orden del 2% del PBI. Ese número cayó en los últimos 20 años a 0.5. Recibimos menos inversión extranjera directa que Perú, que Chile, que Colombia y que muchos otros países. Casi toda la inversión directa que hemos tenido en los últimos años, salvo algunas excepciones para el litio y las energías no renovables y algunas excepciones en la agricultura o en el agroalimentario, han sido fundamentalmente reinversión de utilidades. Así que tenemos un panorama, yo diría, muy negativo que viene de muy largo plazo. Ahora, ¿por qué nos pasa lo que nos pasa? ¿Por qué puedo darles estos números si no están choqueados? Si no estamos choqueados, porque existen estos números y hace mucho tiempo. Bueno, están los que dicen que el mundo nos discrimina. El mundo discrimina a todo el mundo. Están los que dicen que los empresarios argentinos son incapaces de exportar. Es obviamente no cierto. Están los que dicen que no tenemos acuerdos comerciales internacionales relevantes y que porque no podemos exportar con un acuerdo de libre comercio a Europa o a los Estados Unidos, a Japón, no podemos participar del comercio mundial. Mentiras. Si firmáramos acuerdos de libre comercio con los principales países del mundo hoy, nuestra situación, la que yo he descrito y la que ha descrito el profesor Irwin, no cambiaría en lo fundamental. ¿Cuál es el problema de fondo? Una mala macroeconomía, una macroeconomía que no funciona. La primera condición para poder insertarse en el mundo es que la economía funcione domésticamente. Y como muy bien lo explicó el profesor Irwin, y además ustedes lo conocen, la inflación permanente, los déficits fiscales desorbitantes, el gasto público en exceso y que produce niveles de imposición muy altas, los controles de cambio, las crisis recurrentes financieras, los incumplimientos de los contratos, de la deuda externa y de los demás contratos, todo eso ha creado una enfermedad argentina, un malestar argentino que ha hecho que Argentina está prácticamente aislada del mundo y que lo que hace y lo que tiene es muy poco y lo tiene de la misma forma en los últimos 40 años. No cambia. Ahora, ¿qué podemos hacer? Y lo primero que tenemos que hacer, obviamente, es ordenar nuestra macroeconomía. Ya lo hemos conversado en extenso en esta conferencia. Pero sin un reordenamiento profundo de nuestra macroeconomía, sin estabilidad, sin equilibrios fiscales, con menos gasto público, con un Estado mejor organizado, con un sistema monetario relativamente estable, sin ninguna de esas reformas importantes que están ahora en discusión, más toda la desregulación, las posibilidades de que Argentina se inserte en el mundo productivamente son nulas. Vamos a seguir como estamos y empeorando todo el tiempo un poquito más, como lo hemos hecho en los últimos 40 años. Ahora, el segundo tema importante no es solamente reconocer el origen de nuestros males, que no está en la discriminación, no está en la falta de acuerdos internacionales, está fundamentalmente en la inestabilidad de nuestras políticas macroeconómicas y la inestabilidad de nuestro sistema y de organización económica en los últimos 40 años. Ahora, ¿qué hacemos? Lo primero que tenemos que hacer es reconocer nuestros problemas y ordenar la macroeconomía, desregular la economía, hacer las reformas estructurales, hacer lo que ya estamos discutiendo y que se quiere y se pretende hacer. Lo segundo es entender dónde va el mundo. Y el mundo está conociendo cambios muy profundos en los últimos 5 o 10 años, sobre todo en los últimos 5 años. La globalización que ustedes conocen y que representó un éxito tan fabuloso, desde la cual nosotros hubo ganadores y perdedores, y Argentina fue un perdedor, no hay ninguna duda sobre eso. Otros países fueron ganadores, Israel fue un ganador, Chile fue un ganador, Turquía fue una ganadora, muchos países de Europa Occidental y de Europa Oriental fueron ganadores, nosotros fuimos un perdedor. Pero el mundo ese, ese mundo de la globalización posterior a 1947 y sobre todo posterior a la caída del muro de Berlín, se está desplomando. El mundo está cambiando muy profundamente como resultado de una nueva variable que es la geopolítica. La geopolítica está cruzando adversamente la globalización. Lo que era una globalización basada en eficiencia económica, en asignación de recursos basados en el cálculo económico, está siendo afectada muy profundamente por la competencia que se está dando en la actualidad entre China y los Estados Unidos. Competencia que se da en varios campos, pero se da en el campo económico. Creo que todos están al tanto de que el gobierno del señor Trump puso aranceles muy altos a las importaciones chinas, que pusieron restricciones tecnológicas muy importantes, prohibiendo la exportación de nuevas tecnologías en semiconductores, en telecomunicaciones, en defensa, que se impidió la introducción de compañías chinas en los Estados Unidos. En otras palabras, que tanto en el campo del comercio como en el campo de la tecnología hubo una serie de barreras sorpresivas, porque lo sorpresivo de los últimos 10 años no es el surgimiento de China, es el nacionalismo de los Estados Unidos. Es mucho más impactante, porque eran los dueños del circo, fueron los que promovieron la globalización en los últimos 40 años o 50 años, fueron los que lideraban el proceso de globalización y ahora se han dado vuelta, han decidido que las condiciones geopolíticas de rivalidad con China son suficientemente importantes como para tener que cambiar su approach económico y han comenzado en cierta forma a imponer un clima nacionalista y proteccionista en muchas de las actividades de la economía mundial que tenemos que tomar en cuenta si queremos integrarnos al mundo como lo propone con mucha razón el profesor Irwin. Ahora, ¿cuáles son las condiciones de lo que ha sucedido en los Estados Unidos? Primero, ustedes ya saben que Trump puso aranceles y restricciones tecnológicas al comercio con China. Segundo, el señor Biden reforzó esas condiciones, reforzó los aranceles, reforzó las transferencias, las restricciones a las transferencias tecnológicas y además de eso hizo un gigantesco programa de política industrial. Los tres programas que los Estados Unidos con Biden han lanzado, el Inflation Reduction Act, el CHIPS Act y el Infrastructure Act, que juntos suman casi $1 trillón, son programas de desarrollo industrial, de política industrial, completamente contradictorios con las reglas del OMC y las multilaterales de los últimos 70 años. En otras palabras, hemos entrado en un mundo en el cual los principales jugadores, sobre todo los Estados Unidos, pero también Europa, y China, que siempre fue una potencia mercantilista, pero que jugaba el juego, están jugando un juego muy diferente al que jugaron durante los últimos 40 años. Y eso tiene obviamente consecuencias muy importantes para nosotros, porque nosotros queremos abrirnos, queremos integrarnos al mundo, queremos dejar atrás las cosas que mencionó Erwin y que yo mencioné con respecto al cierre de la economía argentina, pero lo vamos a tener que hacer en un contexto político, tecnológico y económico y comercial muy diferente al que existió en los últimos 60 años. Lo que no pudimos hacer cuando era fácil, lo vamos a tener que hacer ahora cuando es difícil. Ahora, ¿es malo eso? No, no necesariamente. Quiero recordarles el siglo XIX argentino. El gran éxito de Argentina entre 1850 y 1930 se hizo en el mundo en el cual no había GATT, no había OMC, no había Banco Mundial, no había Fondo Monetario. Había esferas de influencia. Estaba la zona libre, estaba la zona del franco. Los alemanes tenían su propia zona de influencia en el centro de Europa, los norteamericanos en el Caribe y en Centroamérica. Había lo que se llaman esferas de influencia, que es exactamente lo que está pasando ahora. Y a pesar de eso, Argentina encontró el ángulo y la forma de desarrollar y sacarle provecho a la globalización, exportar, atraer inversiones, atraer inmigrantes y tener un éxito formidable. Ahora, ¿cómo lo hicimos? Bueno, primero teníamos políticas macroeconómicas relativamente razonables, que es el primer problema que ya mencioné que nos ha realmente hundido en los últimos 60 años. Sin políticas macroeconómicas razonables, la posibilidad de insertarse en el mundo son absolutamente insignificantes. Entonces, asumamos por un momento que tenemos éxito, que podemos realmente restablecer un orden macroeconómico que sea sustentable y que sea duradero, y que podemos desregular la economía, reformar la economía, volver a darle un dinamismo y una capacidad de inversión dinámica al sector privado. Supongamos que somos capaces de hacer eso a través de las reformas que se están intentando hacer y que ojalá tengamos éxito y las podamos hacer. A pesar de eso, nos encontramos con un mundo muy diferente al de los últimos 70 años en el campo internacional. ¿Qué vamos a hacer? ¿Cómo lo vamos a hacer? ¿Cómo lo hicimos en el siglo XIX? Bueno, en el siglo XIX, Argentina firmó 20 acuerdos bilaterales. El primero con Gran Bretaña en 1822, el segundo con los Estados Unidos en 1823. Después firmamos con Dinamarca, con Suiza, con Japón, con el Estado prusiano, que antes de que existiera Alemania, firmamos 20 acuerdos bilaterales. ¿Y cómo se llamaban esos acuerdos? Se llamaban acuerdos de navegación, bueno, de amistad, navegación y comercio. Y eran acuerdos que fundamentalmente fijaban las condiciones de comercio y de amistad y de inversión y de movimiento de personas, etcétera, entre los dos países, entre el firmante de un lado y nosotros, y que además de eso incluían dos cláusulas muy importantes: el trato nacional y la cláusula de la nación más favorecida. ¿Qué era el trato nacional? Si firmábamos un acuerdo con los dinamarqueses y 3 años antes habíamos firmado un acuerdo con los holandeses, le ofrecíamos primero a los dinamarqueses la posibilidad de que sus compañías y las personas que vinieran a instalarse a Argentina o invertir a Argentina tuvieran el mismo trato que los argentinos. Y segundo, a través de la nación más favorecida, les asegurábamos que lo que le habíamos dado a Holanda o a Gran Bretaña se lo extendíamos a ellos. Y esa fue la base de nuestro éxito entre 1850 y 1930, sin instituciones multilaterales, con un mundo de esferas de influencia, de conflictos geopolíticos de primera magnitud, con guerra mundial. En otras palabras, si bien el mundo era mucho más difícil en aquella época, fuimos capaces de identificar los productos en los cuales teníamos ventajas, la necesidad de negociar y la necesidad de abrirnos y de participar de la economía mundial. Como era, no como lo imaginábamos, sino como era. Ahora, ¿qué hacer en el corto plazo? Bueno, obviamente una de las cosas que hay que hacer es facilitar que los sectores que potencialmente tienen un gran potencial de crecimiento comercial y económico y de inversión, como son la agricultura, las industrias alimentarias, la minería, la energía, se les facilite, se les abre el camino para poder avanzar y para que el sector privado pueda invertir sin restricciones o por lo menos con la menor cantidad de restricciones posibles como para que puedan crecer. Habiendo hecho eso y habiendo primero asegurado una macroeconomía sólida, estable y duradera, van a aparecer muchos otros sectores. Los empresarios argentinos, no dudemos, van a encontrar muchas otras cosas para exportar o para importar, para invertir. y muchas personas y muchas compañías en el mundo se van a interesar a Argentina si es que les ofrecemos un marco adecuado para su inversión y para su actividad. Y en ese sentido, por más que el mundo esté cambiando en una dirección que no es la más favorable para nuestros intereses, que de todas formas el mundo anterior no lo supimos aprovechar durante los últimos 60 años, yo creo que no hay razón para preocuparse o considerar que no tenemos una gran posibilidad, si decidimos abrirnos al mundo, de participar de ese mundo, a condición que nos adaptemos. Primero, en términos de la política macroeconómica interna, de las reformas de desregulación, privatización, incentivos al sector privado. Y tercero, reconociendo que el mundo va a ser diferente, que las negociaciones van a ser diferentes, que no va a haber grandes acuerdos de libre comercio, sino que va a haber acuerdos bilaterales sobre el litio, sobre el cobre, sobre la seguridad alimentaria con los países que tienen inseguridad alimentaria, que vamos a tener una multitud de acuerdos sectoriales y bilaterales que nos van a permitir abrir nuestra economía y participar de la economía mundial. El otro tema que queda pendiente, que hoy hubo un comentario del profesor Erwin, es el tema del Mercosur. El Mercosur tiene dos características. Primero, el comercio intra-Mercosur es muy modesto. Todo el comercio intra-Mercosur, como porcentaje del comercio de los cuatro países miembros, representa nada más que el 15% del comercio total. El equivalente en el NAFTA es 37% y en la Unión Europea 63%. Así que comerciamos muy poco entre nosotros. El segundo es que Brasil y Argentina han sido muy proteccionistas, tienen una serie de limitaciones muy importantes con respecto al comportamiento internacional, y Brasil no ha estado dispuesto, y Argentina lo ha seguido, a realizar negociaciones internacionales que permitan abrir la economía y negociar con otros países. Entonces, el Mercosur como plataforma de negociación ha sido prácticamente inútil. Como comercio interno ha sido muy limitado y tiene que reformarse. No tiene que relanzarse, sino reformarse. ¿Cuáles son los caminos de la posible reforma? Hay dos caminos. Uno era la propuesta del ministro Guedes y de Bolsonaro, que en líneas generales significaba lo siguiente: bajar los aranceles del Mercosur, que son bastante altos, llegan hasta el 35%, aranceles efectivos, llegan hasta el 35% en algunos sectores, bajarlos del 50%, reducir las barreras no arancelarias entre los países del Mercosur y salir a negociar agresivamente internacionalmente. Esa propuesta que hizo Guedes y Bolsonaro hace cosa de 13 años y medio, 4 años, fue rechazada por Argentina y no se pudo instrumentar. Los aranceles se bajaron del 10%. En otras palabras, pasaron, supongamos, en un producto particular del 30% al 27%, lo cual fue un impacto muy menor. El segundo camino, que es el que yo recomiendo, es transformar el Mercosur en una zona de libre comercio, como lo ha propuesto Uruguay durante los últimos 5 años. Recuperar, en otras palabras, la autonomía del manejo de la política comercial. Tratar de hacer que el Mercosur aumente su comercio interno, reduciendo las barreras no arancelarias, promoviendo la integración, etcétera, pero permitirle a cada uno de los países miembros que negocien internacionalmente los acuerdos que quieran y puedan negociar con respecto a la apertura comercial. Y este segundo camino es para mí el más seguro y el más probable, porque no creo que Brasil, bajo la administración del presidente Lula y de su equipo económico, tenga otra pretensión que mantener un alto grado de proteccionismo en la economía brasileña. Bueno, habiendo dicho esto, creo que he cubierto un poco el territorio de lo que es Argentina, de los problemas que tenemos, de por qué hemos cambiado tan poco en los últimos 40 años, qué es lo que nos pasa, fundamentalmente un problema macroeconómico, de falta de estabilidad macroeconómico, dónde está yendo el mundo y qué es lo que tenemos que hacer. Así que les agradezco mucho y hasta la próxima.
Muchas gracias, Felipe. Como nuestros panelistas se atuvieron a los tiempos, nos quedan exactamente unos 10/12 minutos para algunas preguntas. Todavía recibo preguntas por acá. Me parece que esta es para Johan, que dice: ¿crees importante la eliminación de barreras para comerciar entre países para que el mecanismo de intercambio voluntario funcione correctamente a nivel mundial y no solo país? O sea, que los recursos puedan llegar donde el mercado realmente indique que tienen que estar.
Mm. There was a slight disjunction in the translation in my machine. But as I understand the question, open up markets for trade in resources generally, I think is an incredibly important part of global trade. Because it's generally a way of making sure that places with abundance can fill the areas of shortages. And that's important for simple economic reasons, that you, if you have those resources, you'll be better paid for them, and if you don't, you'll get access to them. That's good enough in itself, but that's also important to make sure that we reduce international tensions. One reason why history has been a long list of endless wars is that the only way to get access to the resources, natural resources, energy resources, and other goods, was to steal it from others. The fact that we can suddenly trade them across borders is not sufficient to make sure that we have eternal peace, but it will at least impose some sort of constraint and approach the 19th century free traders ideal that instead of having soldiers crossing borders, goods and resources will.
Muchas gracias, Douglas. Irwin, yo tengo una pregunta acá que tiene que ver con tu libro Free Trade Under Fire. Free Trade Under Fire es del año 2020. En unos 30 segundos de por qué Free Trade Under Fire. Para que nos expliques las causas que comentaste en el libro, ¿ok?
So the question was about my book, Free Trade Under Fire. I'm not very good at coming up with book titles, but I like that one because it's evergreen. There will never be a time when free trade is not under fire. In fact, I think it's in its fifth edition. The first edition I wrote in 2001 or so because of the attacks made at the Seattle summit of the WTO, when there were riots in the streets of Seattle against the WTO and against globalization, by, in my view, misguided protesters who didn't think globalization would do much for global poverty, that would just help out multinational companies and hurt workers around the world. And I just wanted an accessible alternative to a textbook that would lay out the case for free trade, the case against protection, the case why it's in the interest of developing countries to embrace open markets, why fears about the WTO as being this big government that's going to tell countries what to do is wrong. And what I found is that every 3 or 4 years, there's new empirical evidence, of course, but the fire directed at free trade changes. So now it's national security and global supply chains. Under Trump, it was make America great. We need protectionism, and that's it worked in the past. No, it didn't, but so about every 3 to 5 years or so, I need to come out with a new edition just to address the new, it's sort of like whack-a-mole. New arguments crop up against globalization or free trade, and they need to be beaten down.
I love that book. It's a classic. I love the title as well. But I would love to see a future where we've won the argument, and you can have a new edition called Free Trade on Fire.
Yeah, there you go.
Bueno, y de paso también el libro de Johan sobre el manifiesto capitalista, ¿no? Que me parece que después, si nos quedan 2 minutos, podemos hacer un comentario sobre ese libro que me interesaría escucharlo, Johan. Pero tengo una pregunta para vos, Felipe. No sé si funciona ese micrófono, pero si no, la vemos.
Creo que sí.
No. Genial, excelente, sí. Ahí se escucha perfecto. Bueno, te cuento la pregunta para vos. Dice, ¿podría agregar un par de palabras, comentarios? Y mirá que dice un par de palabras, comentarios. 1 minuto y medio. En relación al conflicto Ucrania-Rusia y la posición de la Argentina?
Bueno, desde el punto de vista económico o político, pregunto, porque no.
No lo dice, así que interpretalo como vos quieras, en 1 minuto y medio.
Desde el punto de vista económico es muy importante lo que está pasando en Europa, porque además de los problemas del conflicto entre China y los Estados Unidos e indirectamente con Europa, se ha introducido en el comercio y en las inversiones internacionales el concepto de sanciones. Las sanciones siempre existieron, pero eran muy limitadas. Había sanciones para Corea del Norte, había sanciones para el Irán porque quería controlar la bomba atómica. Ahora las sanciones se han generalizado. Es que como la OMC no existe más, es una estampilla. Todo lo que se está haciendo en términos de conflicto chino-Estados Unidos, o en el término de sanciones que los Estados Unidos y los países de Europa le están aplicando a Rusia, y las sanciones que Rusia le aplica a ellos, porque las sanciones generan contrasanciones, están creando un mundo donde realmente el comercio y las inversiones internacionales y la transferencia de tecnología están comenzando a tener una dimensión de geopolítica que excede la dimensión económica que fue la característica de los últimos 60 años. Y en ese sentido, el conflicto en Ucrania es un desencadenante y un agravante grande del tema de las sanciones, y yo creo que afecta muy gravemente a la economía internacional y lo tenemos que tomar en cuenta cuando definamos nuestra estrategia. Pero no hay estrategia argentina si no arreglamos primero nuestra economía doméstica. Creo que lo hice claro en mi presentación y lo vuelvo a repetir. La economía doméstica, la macroeconomía y las reformas estructurales son la previa de cualquier intento de Argentina de insertarse en la economía mundial.
Muchas gracias, Felipe. Vieron cómo me hacen caso con el uso del tiempo, ¿eh? Y no tengo mecanismo de enforcement, pero insistí tanto con el uso del tiempo que me hacen caso con el uso del tiempo. Tengo una pregunta que es complicada y va para cualquiera de ustedes tres. Y dice, ¿cuál creen que sea el rol de las criptomonedas y las finanzas descentralizadas en el nuevo mundo multipolar? ¿Ninguno? ¿Erwin? No.
I have no idea.
Johan?
Well, we don't know. And that's why we have to leave it to the market to find out with experiments and trade test it and see what happens. But alternatives are always useful and welcome.
Bueno, y en el mismo, para cualquiera de los tres, ¿qué lugar ocupan las pymes en la globalización? Pymes son pequeñas y medianas empresas. ¿Qué lugar ocupan las pymes en la globalización? Felipe, dale.
Yo creo que, si bien en Argentina estamos concentrados ahora en lo agrícola, lo alimentario, lo agroindustrial, la minería, la energía, yo pienso que si conseguimos realmente estabilizar seriamente nuestra economía, si conseguimos crear una economía estable, consistente y duradera, Argentina no tiene por qué ser muy diferente de Italia. Después de todo, 40% de la población argentina es de origen italiano y Italia está lleno de pequeñas y medianas empresas exportadoras. Yo pienso que Argentina podría transformarse en un gran exportador de pequeñas y medianas empresas con una condición previa, que no son subsidios o ventajas puntuales, sino condiciones macroeconómicas favorables para que puedan hacer su cálculo económico, invertir, tener la certeza de que el fruto de su esfuerzo va a ser retribuido, de que las reglas del juego van a ser mantenidas y que los derechos de propiedad son respetados. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Felipe. Muchas gracias y un fuerte aplauso para nuestros tres panelistas. Este fue el panel sobre globalización y desarrollo. Gracias por su atención.